By his stripes ye were healed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Sin harms us. Whether we like it or not, it is simply the case. Others' sins harm us, whether we like it or not, and our sins harm others, whether we like it or not. Perhaps at this moment, this truth is a little more real, a little more graspable for us than at other times. 22 people dead in the aftermath of a shooting spree in Nova Scotia. Hard to deny that one person's sins have caused terrible harm there. And across our country and the world, we must remind ourselves every day that even our desires to go out and to do good may, in the time of this pandemic, actually be the means of harming the most vulnerable in our society. And so we have begun, or at least by now we ought to have begun, finally to weigh each of our actions carefully according to the first principles of right action, because now each one of our actions is really, really obviously a matter of life or death. But the fact of the matter is that this truth, that sin harms, is no more true now than it has ever been. It's simply more obvious. Each one of us commits sins every day that wound ourselves and wound others. Very often, these are not sins that are obvious even to the people we harm, let alone to ourselves. A harsh word, a fleeting scowl at someone else's words, deliberately not meeting the eye of our colleague at the water heater as we pass by, because we simply can't face his annoying voice this morning before we've had our fourth cup of coffee. Each of these actions is over and done in a moment. And each one wounds our soul and our neighbor's soul in ways that we and even they will likely never realize or remember, and which nonetheless tend to the destruction of their life and ours. Human action is riddled with sin, riddled with the capacity to harm. We sin without thinking. We wound without ever realizing we have wounded, and we bear about in our bodies and our souls the scars of these wounds. Scabbed over, perhaps, no longer gushing, perhaps, but not yet healed. But today, as we move more deeply toward the center of this season of Eastertide, we learn something quite remarkable about our wounds and the wounds of the world. Last week, you'll remember, our Gospel recounted the scene in the cenacle, in the upper room, on the first Low Sunday. Our Lord appears in the midst of the disciples, behind the locked door of the cenacle, behind the locked doors of their fears. And what did he do? He said unto them, "Peace be unto you." And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. He bids them peace, and he shows them the cause of their peace. By his stripes ye were healed, says St. Paul in our epistle this morning. On the first Good Friday, many gazed upon the wounds of the crucified, and even to those who had known and loved him most intimately, there was no sense that those wounds could heal. Each Good Friday, we too gaze upon them, knowing that they can heal, but very likely it's still hard for us to see that very clearly. But in Eastertide, throughout Eastertide, we begin by little and little to see a bit more clearly. And the first thing to notice is this, that in Eastertide we do not cease to gaze upon the wounds of the crucified. In Eastertide we do not cease to gaze upon the wounds of the crucified. Now, on one hand, this is really obvious. In our gospel last week, our Lord showed us his wounds. And today, St. Paul recalls them to our memory. So in one sense, it's obvious because our lessons refer to them. But in another sense, it should perhaps surprise us and should certainly make us wake up from a particularly pernicious dogmatic complacency in which we are all to some extent complicit. The forgetting of the Passion in the celebration of Easter. Please note this carefully. Easter is not the leaving behind of the Passion. Eastertide is the fulfillment of the Passion. The Passion does not go away in Eastertide. The Passion is transformed. Our Lord bears in his resurrected body the wounds inflicted by us at his Passion. Our sins were their cause. And they ever will be, real wounds. But in the resurrection, they cease to be merely the result of human sin, and they become the means of divine healing. Reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, says our Lord to Saint Thomas, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. The resurrected wounds of Christ have become the means of the doubter's healing. Now this morning we're led just a bit more deeply into this mystery. This is thankworthy, St. Peter tells us in our epistle, if a man for conscience toward God endure a grief, suffering wrongfully, and if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example. We are called to bear with suffering, patiently, without seeking to wound in return. In his Passion, our Lord was made for us not only a sacrifice for sin, but also an example of godly life, an example that we are all meant to follow. And this is perhaps the most difficult truth that our religion teaches. We like the idea that our Lord's Passion opens for us the gates of eternal life and blessedness, but we very often resent the idea that we are meant to follow his example of suffering. And yet, there it is, in black and white, unmistakably. If, when ye do well and suffer for it, and take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. So how do we make sense of this aspect of our Christian vocation? Well, again, it can only be through the resurrection. Our Lord bore our sins in his own body on the tree. That is to say, he allowed himself to be wounded. His wounds are simply the effects of our sins. And by his stripes, by his wounds, caused by our sins, we were healed. So notice this. Our sinful actions have their effect. And that effect, ultimately, is the wounds of Christ. Christ's resurrection has an effect. And that effect is to make his wounds, the effects of our sins, the means of healing. So by his stripes, which were caused by our sins, we are healed. That doesn't make our sins good. It doesn't mean, as St. Paul tells us elsewhere, that we should sin boldly, that forgiveness may abound more fully. But it is nevertheless the case that in the resurrection, the wounds of Christ, caused by our sins, become the means of our healing. But the effects of the resurrection are extended to us in baptism, when we are made members of his mystical body. So just as our Lord bore our sins in his body by bearing the wounds that were the effects of our sins, so we, as members of his body, bear the sins of others in him. And just as his wounds have become in his resurrection the means of our healing, so can our wounds, as found in his resurrected body, become the means of others' healing. To seek to wound in revenge is simply to cause further wounds, but to suffer in Christ without wishing to wound is to become a means of Christ's healing. Our wounds become the means of his healing of others. I now rejoice in my sufferings for you, says St. Paul to the Christians at Colossae. He says it to us. And I fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church. This is our calling as Christians. It is a hard saying, and for most of us it is very, very difficult, if not impossible, and we might wonder how we can ever aspire to it, and if we dare to aspire to it, by what means we can learn how to undertake it. Well, we must aspire to it. We simply must, because it's our calling in Christ. There's no doubt about that. And the means of undertaking it is simply to begin to face our wounds, to uncover them in our Lord's presence, to show them to him, even if we can't look upon them ourselves at first, to acknowledge our pain, and to ask him to heal us. That process will almost certainly be very difficult. Perhaps it will initially seem impossible. After all, whenever we tear the dressing off a wound, it opens it up again. It makes it more painful and more obvious to us than it was before we opened it to the air. But it is by laying bare our wounds to our Lord that we learn to trust him. It is by willingly acknowledging ourselves to have been wounded by others, and our wounds have wounded others, that our faith begins to grow. And as our faith begins to grow, we will begin to find healing. And as we begin to find healing, we will come to know in ourselves that we are loved, And as our healing continues and we learn more and more that we are loved, we will then learn to love others. And when we have learned that, then we will have discovered in ourselves the providential governance of the Good Shepherd, who is eternally in our nature, drawing the whole universe to himself, remaking even the results of our sins into means by which he can communicate his divine love to us and to others. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen.
Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. In union, dear Lord, with the faithful at every altar of the Church, where thy blessed body and blood are being offered to the Father, we desire to offer thee praise and thanksgiving. We believe that thou art truly present in the Holy Sacrament, and since we cannot now receive thee sacramentally, we beseech thee to come spiritually into our hearts. we unite ourselves unto thee, and embrace thee with all the affections of our souls. Let us never be separated from thee. Let us live and die in thy love. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus, dwell in thy servants in the fullness of thy strength, in the perfection of thy ways, and in the holiness of thy spirit, and rule over every hostile power in the might of thy spirit, for the glory of thy Father. Amen. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve our bodies and souls unto everlasting life. Amen.